Hello and welcome to this video. In this video, I'm going to discuss the designs, the schematic of OBAL board. So let's start. On GitHub, there is the OBAL board here. This repository contains full description of the board. As you can see, the board, there is a section called schematic. And from schematic, you can see this is the schematic of the board, and you can click here for more details on EasyEDA. Here it is, the project. Let's open it from my editor. Well, here it is, the schematic of the board. When we think, when you develop a board for Ardupilot, you need a processor and couple of sensors. These sensors are mainly connected via I2C or SPI. I'm here talking about building a simple board, so there is no complex wiring or configuration. These OBAL boards are meant to be simple and acts as a test platform. So when I developed it, I developed it with this mindset, is to build something simple and something has no complex in wiring and easy to do. So let's go together and see how can you build a similar board. The first thing, that the Raspberry Pi. The Raspberry Pi, all Raspberry Pis boards, Raspberry Pi 1, 2, 3, 4, and 0, has the same pins. So we have here 40 pins. Some of them, as we can see in the other link, here are the links, the pins. These pins, some of them are mandatory, so you have to use them. Some of them are optional. And this is the trick. What pin are you going to choose and what pin are you going to ignore? For sure, you will use the 5 volt pin. You need the ground pin, and you need the ground pin connected in the board like that. So all ground pins are connected on the PCB, as you can see here. This is a ground pin, and the red area is the ground, is a common ground. Back to the schematic. There is the I2C bus. The I2C bus, I use the I2C, the default I2C bus in the Raspberry Pi that uses pins 3 and 5. So pins 3 and 5 are mandatory. So I labeled them with a green background to mark that they are mandatory, and I have to use them. The other pins that are mandatory are the SPI bus. The SPI bus consists of, as we can see here, 5 pins. The 5 pins is the clock, the master input slave output, and master out master output slave input. Then we have 2 chip select in order to control to activate 2 chips. One of them is the IMU back here. So these are the pins of the SPI. Then we have other pins. These other pins are blue because they are not mandatory. What I mean by not mandatory, I mean that I chose that I will use GPIO 26 or pin number 37 to represent the RC input 5. I could have chose pin number 35 to represent RC input 5 instead. So it's just a selection. It's not a total random selection because there are other considerations, but these considerations are when you are building the board itself. The board, here are the pins that I used for RC input, and here are the RC input pins on the board. Let's see it in a 3D view. Okay, so here are the RC input and here are the RC input pin. So what I want is that there are almost direct line mapping between them without a lot of collisions to reduce the number of vias in the board. So that's why I choose them next to each other, and I chose these pins here so that they are almost directly map one to one without any collisions. Okay, back to this board. As we can see, the I2C bus, you simply connect the SDA and SCL to all the sensors that use I2C. In my case here, I'm using the pressure sensor BMB 180, and it uses I2C bus, so I connect it directly here. I also use I2C for this ADC sensor. This ADC is used, here it is the ADC. This is used to sense the input voltage of the battery. So I exposed here four outputs. You can choose to use in the software. I configured only two pins, one for the current and one for the voltage. But again, you can expand it to support, for example, three cells and the current, or you can choose to select the voltage for the battery and another voltage for another battery if you choose to separate the voltages if you choose to separate or to use two batteries, one for the motors and the other for powering up the board, then you can measure the two voltage together. So here it is the sensor. It uses I2C, so I connect it directly here and directly here. There is no other resistors or wiring, special wiring or anything. All you need to do is to just take out a line from here and connect it directly to the baro and to the analog to digital converter. There is also another device that uses I2C, which is the PCA9685. This is a very useful chip, and this chip produces BWM signals necessary to control servos and motors. It has 16 output pins. This is a large number. And by the way, this chip has a very nice feature where you can change its I2C address so that you can use multiple chips to expand the number of available output up to four times, that is 64 outputs. But in this case, you need to upgrade the Ardupilot driver to support multiple BWMs. Okay, for the IMU, there are some IMUs that can be connected via I2C, by the way, but in our case, you need, and in Ardupilot, normally when you check different designs, you will see that they are all in most cases prefer to connect it to SPI, because SPI here is faster, and they dedicate an SPI bus to IMU so that they can have they can access it fast and get data, get a lot of data in a small time to keep the attitude of the copter controlled. The SPI bus connection, as I mentioned later, as I mentioned before, is very easy. You just need to connect the MUSI here, master output slave input to the MUSI, MISO to MISO, master input slave output, a clock to the clock, ground 5 volts, and then I choose the SPI chip select 0, which is here, which is also here. This is the default pin for SPI chip select 0, and I used it for the IMU. As I mentioned, the other one, I don't use it for time being, but I routed it to the extended output. The extended output can be seen here. This is an extended output for SPI bus, where it has ground, VCC, MUSI, MISO clock, and the chip select, but chip select number 1 rather than chip select number 0 that is used for the IMU. Also, you can see here there are some I2C pins. These I2C can be connected to other sensors as well. For example, you can connect a LiDAR to this I2C to maintain altitude hold. Another one, you can connect it to OLED, so to display meaningful information on a small screen. Is very nice, and it works very nice. Okay, this is the serial board. Actually, when you are using Raspberry Pi Zero, you can access two serial ports. The one, the serial port, the first one is the one that exists here. This is 5 volt ground and TXRX. So these are TXRX, these are TXRX ground and VCC 5 volt. You can connect it directly to the GBS. And the other port exists in the USB of Raspberry Zero. Okay, here it is. Well, this is the USB that you can use as serial port 1, and the other is serial port 0. Serial port 1 can be configured to connect the telemetry, and so using Raspberry Pi 0, you will have one serial port here for GBS and the other for telemetry. For Raspberry Pi 4, for example, you have multiple USB ports, so you can connect and use multiple serial ports. You can simply connect a USB to serial port breakout, and then you will get multiple serial ports. Okay, back here. Now let's check this stuff and the notify. Well, the notify is that I want to control some LEDs, and I want to control a buzzer. These LEDs, again, these LEDs, I can choose the layout, I can choose the pins here. I choose this pin and this pin and this pin for the LEDs, and this pin for the buzzer. I could have chose these pins, they are the same. You only, if you want to change this mapping, you need to go to the source code and just change single number. In other video, I will discuss how to reflect these definitions and this design to the code, and you will see it is pretty easy to change the GPIO to other ports so that it is flexible design. Okay, anyway, this pin headers cannot control LEDs and buzzer directly, especially that I chose to use power LEDs, and these ports are not capable for giving enough current to control these LEDs. So I simply connected this driver. This driver is a very famous chip, ULN 28033A. Okay, the buzzer here, it is a one-to-one port. What I mean by that is that pin number one here is the input for pin number 18 here, which is output number one. Pin number two is output for output number two. So because I'm going to use only four pins and I have eight input pins already, so I chose to connect to use two input pins for each input. For example, the buzzer controls, the buzzer goes to pin 1 and 2. So I can make use of pin 18 and 17 and make use of larger current capacity for free. That was the idea. And from here, you can connect the buzzer directly. The LEDs, you can use power LEDs with resistors 450 ohms, 330 ohms, and it will work very good and it will be bright. Now, let's discuss the external voltage here and the 5 voltage here. Well, because I'm using this chip has an external voltage because it controls servos, so it allows you to supply external voltage. In case of quadcopter and connecting to speed controllers, the speed controllers already can supply you with voltage already, so you can use this VXTER to connect to the LEDs, so that you are using external power here. You don't use the 5 volt from Raspberry Pi, which is not sufficient to run this LEDs and this and the buzzer. Again, there is a switch here. If you connect these pins together using a header, then you are powering the Raspberry Pi board itself, and all this sensor you are powering it. The 5 volt port is VCC, so you are powering it from V plus to VCC, and this VCC is connecting to this and to this pin and to this and to this pin, so you are powering everything. As we can see, the V plus here is connected directly to these pins, so the LED current is not taken from the Raspberry Pi or from the power that's the. As we can see here, the V plus here and here is connected together, so that the LEDs are powered by the external voltage that is supplied from this port to this LED. Supplied from this port because you are connecting speed controllers that capable of providing input voltage. Again, if you connect this together, then the whole port will be powered by the speed controllers here. So this one option to power the board. The other more safe option is to use the PSP, is to use this PSP and give this board an external power dedicated for it and for the sensors. So these sensors and the Raspberry Pi will share the voltage, the power source from the USB, and the BWM and the LEDs will share the V plus or the external voltage here, VXTER. But again, you can connect the V plus, the V external with the VCC, and it will work also fine.